Hello, Planet Earth. Welcome back to my YouTube channel. We're at IDK, my BFF Jill 730. I'm Presnell Young, wishing you warm salutations and congratulations, as always. You've made your way to the Buffington Post. Today, we are finishing up my Season 8 coverage with Buffy the Vampire Slayer Season 8, Issue 40. The Coda, Last Gleaming, Part 5. Yes. Now, interesting, fun stuff to think about as we get into our last issue. I broke out the Library Volume 1 edition to show you just how we started the season, with Buffy looking cute, casually holding the scythe over her shoulder. Just lovely. And by the end, Buffy, of course, not only destroyed the Seed of Wonder, but she broke her own scythe on it when she did it. And now her scythe is broken, she's holding it together, and it's just all bad, and she looks so depressed because Giles is dead and magic is gone, and oh, it's just bad. So yeah, remember I told you that the Seed of Wonder was literally what animated our entire reality? Well, Buffy Dunn hauled off and broke it, and, you know, now there's no magic in our world, but you know, the magic of the Seed of Wonder is basically what created our world and was keeping it alive. You know, our planet was like this living thing. Our whole reality was animated by this magic. Well, now, since Buffy destroyed it, you may be asking yourself, how are we still here? Like, how does the planet and reality still, you know, have any kind of life in it? And what we're going to find out is that, you know, that's part of the problem. You're not far off, and that's some Willow thinking. So if you thought that, good for you, because, yeah, that's pretty much how it's gonna go. So, what's been going down? Twilight happened. It was Angel. Angel was possessed by the Twilight situation after Angel and Buffy made Twilight happen. And then, oops, in trying to protect the Seed of Wonder and Buffy, Giles got himself totally killed by Angel. Neck snap, drop, Giles is dead, which prompted Buffy to basically end the fight for good. Make sure that magic was no longer gonna cause any problems for anybody. So yeah, she hauled off and broke the Seed of Wonder and broke her scythe in doing so, as I've said a few times now. And yeah, Willow, she said that we'd lost. So let's look into what we've lost and what we've gained as we move into our last issue of Season 8. It's Buffy the Vampire Slayer Season 8, Number 40, Last Gleaming, Part 5. Here we go.
Fascinating transition.
Damn it!
So Season 8 began with Buffy saying, the thing about changing the world is, once you've done it, the world's all different. So, you know, we are thrust into Season 8 and all of the craziness, and as we move through Season 8, we get to our last issue, and Buffy says the thing about changing the world is, and we move into where Buffy's life has gone in the months since the events down in Sunnydale. Buffy is working at a cafe. She's pouring coffee in San Francisco. So Buffy is, you know, working as a waitress again, and she's kind of enjoying it for the most part, but really, you know, there's something missing. And so anyway, she's taking a tray of coffee to a table, and this rando girl in there just trips her, and Buffy almost drops her tray of coffee. But she does the single most amazing thing we have ever seen Buffy do. She trips and she catches her tray of coffee on her boot, and from an upside down position, she serves the coffee without spilling it. So, go Buffy, it was amazing. I really like this, it was really funny. It's a really funny gag because you turn the page and Buffy's just got it bounced up on her boot. Super cute. And so, yeah, Buffy's thinking, there's a lot of clumsy people in San Francisco. All of them girls. And so we transition to Buffy talking with Kennedy. And Kennedy's basically saying, Well, what do you expect? All these slayers out there, they don't even want to be called slayers anymore because they don't want to be associated with you. You super literally fucked up the world. And, this is just what you get. And Will, or Kennedy rather, is packing up her stuff, and Buffy's saying, you can't leave right now. Everything's so sensitive. Willow's going through a lot, and she really needs you right now. You can't just leave. And Kennedy says, well, here you go again, genius. Willow dumped me. So we transition to Buffy talking to Willow out near the Golden Gate Bridge. And what Willow is saying is that she broke up with Kennedy because, whether Kennedy realizes it or not, she likes being with a superhero. She likes being with super-powered Willow. And, if Willow can't keep up with Kennedy, because the Slayers, like I said, they've retained all of their powers, but there's not going to be any more new magic. So this is what Willow is saying to Buffy, but Buffy says, yeah, we've already had this conversation several times, Willow. Every time we start talking about anything, you get off on this tangent about how there's no more magic. Throughout the issue, people are going to be telling Buffy things that she's already heard, that she's just going to be hearing the same thing. You did something wrong. You did something wrong. And she knows it. She gets it. But she did what she did. There's no taking it back. And she did stop this fight. And so, say what they will, but Buffy took the only way out that was available to her. Buffy says, Kennedy doesn't just need you to be super. I mean, you're really handy with computers and all this good stuff. But Willow says, what you did, Buffy. And Buffy's like, yeah, I did it. And she says, no, you don't understand. What you've done, it doesn't seem like it now, but the world has really lost something, something that it needed. And it may not seem like it yet, but our world is basically dying, is what Willow tells us. And so Buffy's like, well, it's not that big a deal. You've given up magic before, right? Like, what's the diff? And Willow says, no, dude, it's not about that. Don't even pretend like you think I'm that stupid little girl who's just going around playing with magic. It's so much more important than that. And the truth of the matter is, I'm leaving Kennedy because there's someone else. And I tried to hide it from myself. I tried not to admit it, but this was coming. There's been someone else for a while now. And she says it's somebody that I'll never see again. And she is, of course, talking about Alowyn, the Saga of Hisuki, the sexy snake lady. And, that's Willow can't get in contact with her. Like I've been saying all season, it was never like expressly stated, but they were very like sexy with one another. And Willow was learning and experiencing a lot when she was with Alowyn, and that is the kind of relationship that Willow needs at that point in her life. She needs somebody who's exciting and mysterious and going to challenge Willow to really just be herself as much as she can. So Buffy is remembering the death of Giles at Angel's hands. And we see that Angel doesn't understand what happened. He's saying, Buffy, what happened? Did we win? And no, we didn't really win because we lost Giles and we lost magic. And for all intents and purposes, we lost Angel because how can we trust him ever again? Like, really, how can anyone ever trust Angel? One thing I don't like about season 8 is what it does to Angel and the fact that he's the bad guy, and then he's the super bad guy because he kills Giles after we decided that he wasn't the bad guy. So, whatever. So, Dawn wakes Buffy up because she had been dreaming about this whole thing. And yeah, Dawn and Xander are apparently shacked up in San Francisco, and Buffy's crashing on their couch for the time being. So, Xander goes off to work. He's got some kind of construction job, and Buffy and Dawn are talking and having coffee. And just talking about what's going on in their lives. And, Buffy's talking to Dawn about the fact that she's going to school now and she's kind of taken herself away from the fight. And Dawn's saying, since you destroyed the Seat of Wonder, there really is no fight anymore, no new demons anyway. And so Buffy says, there's still plenty of vampires and I can go out and patrol and do my job and all this fun. So, whatever, whatever. They talk about Harmony, and apparently Harmony's reality show had been canceled, But vampires are still the cool new thing. Harmony is like on Dancing with the Stars, and so like everything on TV, movies, it's all vampire-tastic, just like it was in the real world, which Buffy is reflecting. And so they're talking about, the fact that there is no army of slayers anymore, and Dawn says, part of you must miss it, you must miss being what you were meant to be, a leader instead of just bossy all the time. And Buffy doesn't really miss the army or the being in charge. She never really wanted that, but she felt like she opened up this door at the end of season 7, and she went on this crazy journey, and by the end of season 8, she's basically, broken what she made. And she says she feels like everybody else just kind of woke up and I didn't get to, because everybody else can kind of go back to their lives, whether they like it or not. They can kind of go back to their lives after this. But Buffy, her whole life has pretty much been being Buffy the Vampire Slayer. So there's nothing for her to go back to. She literally, her parents are dead for all intents and purposes. We don't think about Buffy's father. Her hometown isn't there. And now this fight that she was fighting is just gone. It's over. Like, all of these women have abandoned her. They were so bitter and angry with Buffy for basically taking away their legacy and their reason for being that, like I said, they don't even call themselves Slayers anymore. They've just all disbanded. But Buffy and Dawn, it's so lovely to actually have them together being sisters. This is what happens when you take away all of the craziness that we started with in season 8. You just have the core group, minus Giles. So here we go. We've got Buffy and Dawn. They are just chilling at the house being sisters, which is what they really need from one another at this point in time. So then we pick up with the general guy, the one who was hanging out with Amy and Warren and Twilight for a while. All right. So basically, the military's pretty much wrapped up their whole Twilight agenda, and they're painting it like it's this whole great thing. And he's talking to his wife on the phone, and he's saying, "I'm coming home for dinner. It's all over." And so he gets onto the elevator, and holy shit, Simone is there. Remember Simone with the island and the pink hair and the mohawk and
guns. Yeah.
so Simone shoots this motherfucker. Soon as the elevator opens, just shoots him straight in the middle of the head, and she says, "It's over for some of us." Meaning it's not over for her. So Simone is clearly like on some other. And so we flash back to Giles' funeral, and we see that, well, Giles left his farmland, his houses, his money, everything. He left everything to Faith. Yeah, he left it all to Faith. And Buffy is just devastated. And I don't think it's really because she wanted anything from Giles. It's just that he gave it to Faith. You know what I mean? Like, all season 8, Giles has been hanging out with Faith, playing buddy buddy with Faith, and Buffy didn't like it that much. And now here he is, he's leaving his entire life to Faith, and Buffy just feels really betrayed. And so we pick up with Buffy, who is gone, and she's like in Giles' apartment, which is now Faith's. And Faith is just like, "Dude, I don't know. I don't get it either. Like, I wasn't expecting this at all. This is like the furthest thing from my mind. I thought you would definitely get everything. Everybody knows you're the number one son." And so she says, "The only thing I can think is that Giles basically thought I was just pussy and that you were stronger and I would need all this help. But he did leave you something. He left you this one crappy thing. And you know what it says?" And she hands her the vampire book. The one that Giles like plops down on the library counter in the very, like, in the pilot episode, right? So, yeah. She says, "You know what this says? It says you're the Slayer. You're the only Slayer, and you always were." And Buffy says, "Then I really did fail." Because that's what season 8 has been all about, trying to share this power. And when it comes right down to it, even Giles knew that she couldn't. And that's not what we want. So Faith says, "You know, you look at this whole Slayer thing as being something great and awful at times, but the fact of the matter is, it really messed up a lot of these girls that you threw into this fight. And I spent a lot of my time putting those girls back together, or at least helping them figure out how to put themselves back together. She says, you haven't seen everything. And it turns out it's going to be, like, good practice for what I've got coming ahead of me. And Buffy says, well, do you think you can handle it? And we see that Angel is being kept at Giles' Faith's house, and that she's going to try and rehabilitate him. And Faith says, I don't know if I can handle it, but I'm the only one who's willing to. Nobody else will either acknowledge him, or they just want him dead. So it doesn't matter if I can or not. I'm going to try, because I'm all about forgiveness. And this is exactly what Angel did for Faith way back in season 4/season 1 of Angel. He reached out, he went out on a limb for Faith to prove that she could be better than what she was. And it's really come full circle for Faith, for her to do that for him. And so then we get Spike, and Spike comes around and he says, hey, there's somebody after you, and I don't know who it is, but, you know, whatever, you're in danger. And she's like, oh, well, that's a lot of help. You know, it's really helpful. Giles' super helpful book that he left me. So they're talking back and forth, and he can't come in because she can't invite him in because, you know, she's crashing with Xander and Dawn at this time. So basically, Spike tries to give Buffy this great big pep talk about how, you know, she did this awful thing, but the fact of the matter is, she's the only one who could have made that decision. And she's always the one who has to make these decisions. She was watching Giles die. There was hell raining down from the sky. There was this whole crazy battle. And when it came down to it, she stopped it. She did what she had to do. And Spike saying, yeah, it may be awful, but you're the only one in the position to make these awful decisions. And so Buffy just starts weeping. She's so tired of everybody telling her that she's done this crazy bad thing. She gets it. But at the same time, just like Spike's saying, you know, she felt like she had to. But she's just so tired of hearing it, you know? Like, I get it. I ruined the world. What the fuck else can you tell me that I don't already know? And so then Spike flies off on his bug spaceship, whatever. And I get it. I mean, it's just so ridiculous. Like, Spike, anyway. So Buffy's trying to sleep, but she keeps hearing these, like, sex moans coming out of Dawn and Xander's bedroom. And so Buffy is getting really uncomfortable, and she finally just abandons ship. She jumps out, she says, I'm gonna go patrol, and we see that Dawn was just fucking with Buffy. She was on the other side of the door, just, like, making these, like, sounds. And Xander was in the shower the whole time, so go, Dawn, you're really funny. And Buffy actually says, if I didn't know Dawn better, I'd say that she did that on purpose. So anyway, we get Buffy going around through the city skyscape, just like Frey did. You're just kind of hopping from building to building. So I'm glad that Buffy's getting used to that, at least. And so she's like, wow, you know, the city at night, it just feels right. It feels like home. And wham, she gets a hit in the head. And the homegirl who, like, tripped her earlier shows up, and she's like, you don't belong here, we don't want you here, blah, blah, blah. Buffy goes, I thought that San Francisco was supposed to be really tolerant. Yeah, so anyway, she and two other Slayers bombard Buffy, and they're basically like, we don't want you here, you need to get out of our town. And Buffy goes, look, dudes, I'm not going to fight you. It wouldn't be fair, right? And so they were like, well, maybe that's not up to you. Maybe we can just jump you and you won't stand a chance. And Buffy says, you really don't want to do this, girls. And so here they go. They descend on Buffy. This is straight out of issue 2 from The Long Way Home. She calls upon Leah, Rowena, and Satsu to come in and kick her ass. But as we saw in the second issue, it's that Slayers don't work well together. They just don't. It's an ongoing theme throughout the entire season, this army that Buffy created. It's more or less impotent because the Slayers generally can't work together. Buffy just handles these girls, and she actually grabs one of them and uses her and like, hits another girl with her. It reminds me of this meme that's out there. It's like, I beat a motherfucker with another motherfucker. And yeah, it's really funny. I'm gonna have to find it before I finish editing this. So yeah, anyway, Buffy just takes out these girls and she says, look, I didn't go through this whole season 8 bullshit just to, you know, be fighting other slayers. And they go, we're not slayers. And she says, oh, that's right, you're not slayers. Well, I am. I'm Buffy the motherfucking vampire slayer, and if you bitches step to me again, or if I even get a dirty look from you, I will fight you. And that's gonna be a bad day for you. So Buffy didn't like having to do this, but at the same time, she was expecting it. Everybody feels really betrayed by Buffy. Basically, you know, from the moment she started bonking Twilight, she was bringing this upon herself. And so in the final frames of the issue, we see Buffy, or we get Buffy kind of narrating to us about betrayal and how it just kind of sends ripples out there and people are all coming back. And so we see Willow, who is looking at a picture of Alowyn in a book. And we get the fairy girl from issue number 5, The Chain, the fairy girl that had made friends with the decoy Buffy. And we see Simone, she's got a kill list. She's already got 2 marked off and Buffy's next. And then we see this one guy who's going to be a real problem next season. And then we see the punchline. Buffy says the trouble with changing the world is you don't. And we see that there are always vampires chasing after women in alleys. And she says, you know, you might not change it at all, but you certainly don't do it all at once. Not like I tried to do it. You have to do it little by little, like Sisyphus. And you may never get that boulder up the hill, but hopefully by the time you're done, you have at least moved it up a little bit. You hope. So, let's go to work. And that's where we end the season, you guys. Oh my gosh, can you believe it? We have gone through 40 of these motherfuckers. Yeah, I really can't think of a better way to end the season than with this really character-driven issue. We need to see what's at stake for our characters. The only character that we really won't get to spend a whole lot of time with here is Xander, apart from Andrew. We get to spend some real quality time with Buffy that isn't like plot, 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 plot. It's all what's going on within the character. And we get to spend some good quality time with Dawn. And I love the little joke that they put in there for Dawn, just to remind us that, you know, being at home with the Scoobies was fun. We didn't have to be all over the world, you know. Our characters and our writers are really good at making us laugh and, you know, getting the point across about our characters. And so, you know, everybody gets a lot to do here. And I have to say, Kennedy, I like Kennedy. Iadi Limón, I feel like, I don't know if they just kind of rushed Kennedy's entrance to the season and her relationship with Willow. I feel like they did kind of rush it because as soon as she was there, it's like, oh, there's, you know, Willow's new love interest. But within the comic, Kennedy's great. She always supports Willow. She's always there for Willow, and she always believes in Willow. Usually, when Willow doesn't believe in herself, Kennedy has always been there, even in the show, to say, I believe in you. You can do this. And to see Willow, you know, toss her away for this idea, you know, Alowyn is not even attainable now, but Willow, because she was having these feelings, now that she can't have Alowyn, she's leaving Kennedy. It's kind of fucked up. Like, Willow's really fucked up. But at the same time, Buffy done fucked her up. I'm actually going to do a video about looking at season 8 and using Willow as a proxy for the reader, for the audience, because Willow, I feel like, really does represent us throughout season 8. And I'll go into more detail about that when I do that video, but I feel like it's a strong argument to make, and it's a good way to help you kind of look at all of season 8. The stuff with Faith, I like that Faith... What I didn't say in the last issue was, you know, when Giles came and took the scythe from Faith to take to Buffy, you really you really get the sense that Faith has come to look at Giles the same way that Buffy does, because they have spent all of this time together and he has, you know, kind of put himself out there for Faith. And so she's lost something too. And it's not the same thing that Buffy lost. It's probably a lot more mature and, you know, on a level playing field. Whereas Buffy is always subservient to Giles. I feel like what we saw of Giles and Faith throughout season 8, they were equals. And I just really like that for the Faith character, and I will be doing Faith in season 8, and that will go in my Faith playlist, because you know I love Faith. And yeah, there's not a whole else left to say about this. Spike, he was here, he was gone, he was a flash in the pan. I'm not the biggest Spike fan. When he does stuff, that's great, I think it's great, but for the most part, I feel like we've really just... I want Buffy to have a love interest who is not a vampire, and specifically one who is not Spike. I feel like I won't even go into it right now, but that's how I feel. Yeah, we didn't get a whole lot of Xander, and we don't really know where Andrew is at this point, but we know that Xander is at work, which is great because Dawn's got to go to school, so she can't have a full-time job. That's pretty much all for today, you guys. Stay tuned for a Season 8 wrap-up with Twilight Explained portions in it, and a Season 8 through the eyes of Willow, and Faith in Season 8 coming up soon. I'm glad you stuck around and made it through all of Season 8 with me. Thanks so much. I hope you will subscribe. If you've made it this far, go ahead and give that video a thumbs up, please. I'm Preston L. Young. I hope you're having a great 2015 so far. Have a great day. We'll see you next time. Bye. Where do we go? Go from here.
The battle's done and we kind of won, so we sound our victory cheer. Where do we go from here?
Why is the path unclear? We know home is near.